Please join me in welcoming to the Distinctive Voices podium, Mr. Wesley Vandiver.
How's that? Volume okay? Will that work? My name is Wes Vandiver. I'm with the District Attorney's Office, and essentially I'm an accident investigator. That's all I know in terms of police work. There's lots of areas of police work. This is the only one I know. It's a little bit of an unusual position, and so I'd like to show you basically what my environment consists of. That's essentially my laboratory. That's the environment that I work in as part of what we have here in Orange County, which is a dedicated vertical prosecution vehicular homicide unit. We have attorneys and myself dedicated to these crimes. We are at least the first in the state to do so, and we take these crimes very seriously, and I'm here to talk to you about some of the newer technology that we're actually able to use. In police work, the traffic investigator guy is not a real sought-after position. It's not sexy, okay? Why do people become a cop? Why would you become a cop? You want to ride a motor, right? You want to ride a bike, or you want to work robbery, homicide. You know, maybe you want to be a gang detective or have a canine unit. The traffic guys are the geeks. It's just not very sexy. Well, I was perusing some stuff. You know, why would you become an accident investigator? Well, from the time that I was growing up, I found some ads. And I look at these and I go, well, wait a minute. I'm a cop. And I'm going, so they'll pay you decent. They'll give you a car. Earn as you learn. You're not going to have to work very hard. And you can actually be kind of stupid. Only average education. And beyond that, if that doesn't do it for you, we'll give you a pretty girl. You know what? I mean, look, and then they'll actually work on you. You're in demand. And so I think maybe it was some sort of destiny, you know, that there's something to be said for a traffic geek. You know, I'm sure at some point as a child I practiced that pose. You know? In any case, so what does a traffic investigator or a collision reconstructionist do? What do? Well, we work with evidence. And, you know, we get skid marks and scrapes and scuffs and gouges on the road and, you know, damage on cars and things. And we use some methods, and oftentimes we'll try to do something like this, where we'll call it a dynamics diagram or a motion analysis, because the key to actually potentially reconstructing this crash, this event, is understanding the motion. We may apply mathematics at some point, but mathematics only describe motion. If you get the motion wrong, everything else is wrong. So we'll do something like this. We may go, hey, let me do some fancy whiz-bang mathematics over, we would call this like a crush analysis. Well, let's look at how much energy it would take to deform that car. And from that, maybe we can work that into some sort of speed solution, figure out how fast somebody was going. You know, that might be important in a certain investigation. And we go, okay, well, another thing we might look at is something called conservation of linear momentum. We do, it's a fancy way of saying a billiard ball analysis. If things come in, certain masses and certain speeds, certain angles, they'll go out certain speeds and certain angles. And we just work that backwards. We know where they hit and where they went out, and we'll come back and do this and solve for this. So that might be something. Well, we have in the last, I'll say, decade or so, basically come on a new tool. There's a new tool to help us. Sometimes it's called a black box. Sometimes it's called an event data recorder, or EDR. And for traffic people, it's pretty far out there. We're used to measuring tapes, you know, and roll meters where you roll measurements, you know, and that kind of thing, and, you know, taking measurements of dents, you know, and crush damage and that kind of thing. When you think of science and law enforcement, you would tend to think of what, maybe DNA? You know, that's a big popular one. Maybe computer forensics, you know, what they're doing with, you know, bin Laden's terabytes of data right now, taking it apart and looking at it. That's what people traditionally think of in terms of science applications and law enforcement. But we have a new one. There's a lot of information about it out there, and I'm going to try to give you, obviously, accurate information. But I thought I'd show you something, basically how it's perceived.
It was after midnight, and Edwin Matos was on his way home.
Still a nightmare to me.
He was driving his 2002 Pontiac Grand Am down this Florida stretch of road when the unthinkable happened.
They only see a shadow. What's a split of second?
Matos's car slammed into another car that was backing out of a driveway. Inside, two teenage girls.
I would give my life for the life of those two girls.
He was too late. The girls died instantly.
What Matos didn't know that night is that he wasn't alone in his car. Well, not exactly. Inside, attached to the airbag system, was one of these. It's an event data recorder, similar to the ones used in airplanes. EDRs, as they're called, record 10 seconds before a crash and less than 1 second after a crash. Today, more than 40 million cars on the road have that device inside them. It could be in your car.
Car manufacturers say they need it to monitor the airbag system. And guess what? If you try to tinker with it, your airbag won't work. Even worse, the information hidden inside the recorder could one day be used against you.
The airbag saved my life. The event data recorder sent me to prison the rest of my life.
These days, Matos is known as inmate number 518122. He's serving 30 years at this Florida maximum security prison. At his trial, the data recorder served as a silent witness to the crash. The device said Matos was driving over 114 miles per hour.
Were you driving 114 miles
no,
an hour?
No. If I'd been driving 114 miles per hour, this conversation never happened. I'd be dead.
In fact, the state's own witness estimated Matos's speed between 80 and 90. His accident reconstruction expert put it at 60. Matos says he remembers driving 50, which he admits was still 20 miles over the speed limit.
When did you first find out that this data recorder was in your car?
When my attorney told me.
You paid for your car, and no one ever told you about this data recorder?
No.
Is this a matter of privacy versus safety? Are car owners' hands tied? Robert Strasburger represents the largest car manufacturers in the country.
The event data recorder will never harm you.
Try telling that to the people event data recorders have helped convict, like Michelle Zimmerman. Her passenger, a close friend, died when Zimmerman hit an icy patch and crashed. At trial, the EDR said she was going nearly 20 miles an hour over the speed limit. State accident reconstructionists initially said she was not speeding. But Zimmerman was still convicted and sentenced to prison. Like Edwin Matos, Zimmerman is working on an appeal.
So I'll cut it off there. Some interesting things in there, and some of it true. Well, obviously, if the media says it, it's true. I mean, let me, you know, backtrack on that. Some of it, perhaps, not so much, and we'll talk about that. Anybody remember these days when you worked on a car and the tool of choice was a wrench. You know, when, yeah. You look at that engine bay and you go, wow, you know, 289 V8 on a 66 Mustang, that can actually be worked on. And so what do we have now? A very simple little Ford Focus. I mean, this is nothing fancy. And that's just wire looms all over the place, sensors, electronics. You don't pull out a wrench right away, do you? You pull out a scan tool and start figuring out what kind of error codes and trouble codes and things, you know, you've got on your car. It turns out if you actually look at a car, we've got sensors all over the place in just a very standard, typical car. You know, we've got sensors to tell us what, if somebody's sitting in the right front seat, because obviously if there's a child in the right front seat, what, you don't want the airbag to go off, right? We've got sensors all over the engine compartment telling us if we've got proper air and fuel mixture. We've got sensors on the EGR valve. We've got sensors on the emissions controls. We've got sensors on the manifold, you know, for pressure, throttle position sensors, all over the place. Our cars are really much more electronic these days than they are mechanical. Well, why is that? Why? I mean, electronics have progressed in all facets of life, but in cars, why is that? Basically, for a lot of reasons, but one of them is these. We want to know. We want information. We want data. When something's going wrong, we want to know. If a valve has failed and then it's going to cause a bigger problem, we would like to know now. So it's not uncommon for us to get what? Maybe a check engine light? You can get a check engine light if your gas cap is loose, right? Because that's an emissions problem. We want these things. I mean, can most of you imagine if you were able to tell your father or grandfather that your vehicle will tell you when you're low on windshield washer fluid? I mean, you know, that we have these sensors and warning lights all over our car for data, not only for us, but obviously when we get that check engine light and we go to the mechanic, what's the mechanic going to do? Is he going to sit there and tap and listen and start adjusting things, trial and error? No, that eats up too much time. He's going to take a scan tool, plug in under your dash, and say, wow, you got trouble code, you know, DT, you know, 1280, and that's a bad EGR valve. You need one of those, and that's $500. That's the process. And I've got to tell you, I know we have lots of things on our cars, and I know we have lots of sensors and warning lights. I am of the opinion we need one more. I think we need a sensor for this. We all get stuck behind the people that are, you know, going 40 in the fast lane. And so I would be a proponent of somehow sensing that. With electronics in mind, how does all of this happen? How is it that all of this communication takes place? And it goes something like this. We have either a Class 2 serial bus or what they call a CAN bus system, which is a fancy way of saying your car's network. Your car essentially has its own intranet. And all of these sensors from that previous slide, they're all talking to each other. And they're exchanging data at a very high rate, sometimes 20 or 30 hertz, you know, which is 30 times per second you may have a sensor reporting. Things like wheel speed sensors, those are real important in ABS. If your analog braking system's going to work, you want an accurate speed from that wheel to know if it's sliding or rotating. And so we have some basic control modules throughout the car. One of the main ones, perhaps the main one, is something called a PCM. And that stands for Powertrain Control Module. It's realistically, potentially, the main brain of your car. It's underneath the hood in the engine compartment, and it is sending things back and forth all over the car. This is your car's network. It's how things happen in terms of exchange of information and data. So, turning this over to our airbag systems. Airbags actually used to be mechanically driven, just like, you know, the old versus the new. Airbags actually used to deploy based on a small mechanical device. Well, with airbags, we have also moved to electronics. Airbags used to be essentially a little component or perhaps more than one, up maybe around your radiator support. And if you cut one open, which, I mean, you need to use the Dremel, so you cut one open, and it actually worked like this. It was essentially a ball bearing, a little gold-plated ball bearing in a tube. And when you hit something, the ball bearing, which was normally held back in place by a magnet, the inertia would have the mass overcome the magnetic pull, and the ball bearing would fly forward, touch these two contacts, completing the electrical circuit, and the bags would blow. Very simple ball in a tube. That's what deployed our airbags. Like anything else, we've moved to electronics. And so now we have something called this. The generic name is an airbag control module. You saw the reporter holding one up. Looks just like this. They go by lots of different names. The generic name is airbag control module. This is inside your car. So we've got advanced electronics, sensors all over our car. We've got airbags that have shifted from mechanical to electronic. We've got these now that instead of a mechanical device, there's no ball bearing in here, it's actually an accelerometer, which is a small electronic device that's able to sense acceleration, positive or negative. So we can call it deceleration, which is not physics pure, but it's a pretty good word. We should call it negative acceleration. This thing can sense that. This is a decision maker. This box decides if your airbags deploy. This is the decision maker. It is programmed with algorithms. Now, instead of just one set of circumstances, hey, if the ball flies forward and touches the contacts, deploy. We can actually put multiple algorithms in these because crashes vary. If you hit a wall, a tree, which is a narrowly focused impact, or another vehicle, well, what about the back of a big rig? That's slightly stiffer than the trunk of a car. We can put multiple algorithms in these and have multiple deployment strategies. We've got this going on, and then the federal government steps in, because things are always better when the federal government steps in. In 1997, NTSB, National Transportation Safety Board, issued a directive to NHTSA and the manufacturers of automobiles and said, it's many pages, the gist of it is this. Hey, let's start looking at crash pulses and other crash parameters in actual crashes, real world crashes, and let's start looking at these with sensing and recording devices. The government said, start gathering this information. What do we mean actual crashes versus what? Well, that's how we crash test a car, right? You guys see this on the news. We run it into a barrier. How often do you think this mimics a real world crash? Of the crashes you see driving around town, how often do people hit barriers? It just doesn't happen. Cars hit other cars. So the goal of this was, let's start collecting data in the interest of automotive safety on real world crashes. And they actually dictated, remember, going back, start gathering crash pulses and other crash parameters. And so skipping through our video, what's a crash pulse? I mean, that sounds like a fancy word. This is a crash pulse. Basically, here's our G's. When you hit something and are subjected to terrific forces, you're probably going to get slowed down. Negative acceleration. We're going to measure it in negative G's. And over a very short period of time, and just so you know, that's about 1/10 of 1 second. Typical crash, the common number we talk about in the industry is about 120 milliseconds. Just more than 1/10 of 1 second is how long a crash takes. Let's look at the pulse, the G's, that happen during that 1/10 of a second. That's what the government said. We want you to start collecting in real-world crashes versus barrier-type crashes. Okay, so we got a crash pulse. And now here's one of the more surprising things that people oftentimes don't know about airbag systems. The conventional wisdom is that airbags deploy when there's a crash bad enough that they should deploy. I mean, that seems logical, doesn't it? Well, it's not true. Airbags deploy when they predict the crash will be bad enough to warrant a deployment. They're actually predictive. They cannot wait until the crash is bad enough because they will do no good. They evaluate that developing crash pulse and predict that the crash will be bad enough. Airbags, in a perfect world, will fully deploy in about 65 milliseconds, 65 one-thousandths of a second from impact. They have to make that deployment decision in about 15 to 50, commonly referred to numbers. These are averages. Well, the crash takes 120 milliseconds, and they've got to make a decision in 15 to 50. Otherwise, they're not effective. It's a really bad thing if you crash, you go here, and then the bag deploys. That's really bad. They have to deploy so that they reach full deployment at about the time you come meet them. They have to predict the severity of the crash. It's where the electronics really come in handy. So we take another pulse, and we go, hey, this thing can't be deploying airbags on every little bump. I mean, imagine every little pothole, or you park too hard at Walmart and hit the little curb stop. Now you'd have bags going off. So there's got to be a threshold to wake them up. So sometime after this very first little point of impact, we'll call it, sometime after that, there's a certain severity it takes to wake this thing up. And it wakes up and says, something's going on. I should consider this. Sometime after that, it issues a deployment command. But look, the crash is very young, we'll say. The crash has a long way to go. It's going to get really bad really quick. And this seems a little bit odd, but let me show you. I'll let this loop a couple of times, but watch how bad the crash is when you first see the bag. No, there's cameras all over the place with flashes. They've got 23 views of this when they do a crash test. Now remember, I told you a crash lasts about 120 milliseconds. Here's milliseconds from contact. There's a tape switch right there. And I told you 15 to 50 for deployment. Well, here's your count. See how early that bag starts to come out? It has to. And obviously, there's a delay. I mean, there's a physical, mechanical delay in getting that thing out. So that decision is made before you see that bag. So, we've got all kinds of communication going on. We've got this PCM running our car, sending data all over the place. We've got modernization, electronics, saying, hey, let's not have a ball bearing anymore. Let's actually have an electronic gizmo, and we'll call it an airbag control module. We've got the government saying, hey, you know what? Let's actually, and remember, this has an accelerometer in it for the deployment of the bags. Let's capture crash pulses, which this thing would do internally. It measures the pulse internally. It needs nothing else. It's an accelerometer in the thing. But you remember the other verbiage? Other crash parameters. While we've got this thing hooked up and we've got a really nice network of data, let's grab it once in a while, maybe around the time of a crash. And what should we grab? Well, let's grab some relevant data. What do we want to know out of a crash? How fast somebody's going? That seems to be always question number one. Would you like to know if somebody's wearing their seatbelt? Yeah, let's grab that too. Would you like to know where their foot is on the throttle? You know, lightly applied or to the floor? Yeah, let's grab that. The parameters vary amongst makes and models and years and everything. So all of a sudden, that airbag control module now becomes an airbag control module with event data recording capability. That's your black box. So there's a black box in your car. It's actually the module that deploys your airbags. And it's internally measuring a crash pulse. The government likes that. And by the way, it's going to grab some data. And so typically, we talk about, it varies amongst makes and models and years and things like that. It seems typical, and it's about to get standardized in the next couple model years. The feds have come out and said, all right, everybody's collecting different stuff. Let's standardize this. And so if you collect, we're going to mandate what you actually do record. Typically, if cars get what they call pre-crash data, in other words, how fast you were going at the time of the crash, a lot of them tend to get 5 seconds. And it's labeled -5, -4, -3, -2, and -1, and almost like a countdown to crash. And the way I explain it to juries is this. Think of it as a tube. You've basically got a tube with data flowing through it, and this tube is about 5 seconds long. And so there's this constant stream of data going through. When there's a crash, cap the ends of the tube. Hold on to that. And that's kind of roughly how it works. These are actual black boxes. These are flight data recorders. They have one job. They don't control anything. They don't sense anything. They don't diagnose anything. They have one job. Survive a crash and record a lot of stuff. These are actually not black boxes. Now, we call it that, and I mean, we'll refer to it during trial when I'm on the stand. It's just easy. Call it the black box. It's really not. It's an airbag control module. So much so that different manufacturers even call them different names. Acronyms abound. So General Motors would tend to call it an SDM, which is Sensing Diagnostic Module. Ford likes RCM, Restraint Control Module. Chrysler is ORC, Occupant Restraint Controller. The generic term sometimes, Event Data Recorder. You've heard me use ACM, Airbag Control Module. They kind of have a lot of names. What can be recorded? The list is much longer than this. These are things that are fairly regularly recorded. Right up top, vehicle speed. But various cars will tell you, for example, a common parameter is braking. Was somebody braking? But all you know is, was the brake switch activated? How hard do you have to push your brake pedal to activate the brake lights? You can just rest your foot on it. And typically, that's all we know. We don't know a level of braking. We just know that brakes were applied. But some of the cars go, well, tell you what, we'll give you a little more data. We'll tell you if ABS or analog brakes was actuated. Well, you know you got to stomp your brake for that. So we'll know if it's maximum braking or something less. That seems to happen, occasionally. So what can't they do?
All right, I'm on it. Hey. Wife tried to stonewall, throw suspicion on the business partner.
Horatio called to tell you that?
He called to say the wife says SWAT damaged the car, but that's not their MO.
Well, I can tell you SWAT didn't do that. Silver paint, severity of damage, that's vehicular impact.
It's an accident Lucy Maddox wouldn't know about.
Paint's still flaked and hanging on. It means it's recent.
Could be relevant to the case.
This car is an event data recorder. It means we're going to be able to tell who our victim had an accident with.
So what exactly does this thing do?
This is fantastic.
It documents accidents. It senses any deceleration over 1G force and it automatically records for 15 seconds.
So if Maddox were in an accident today, the footage will be here?
Yeah, hopefully someone with motive.
Well, you know what that means. It's possible the SWAT call was meant to finish off Maddox after the accident.
Got a plate.
This is the best.
See that? Put out a bullet.
No. In a word, no. In our dreams. It'd be nice if they could just, you know, fingerprint him and have him sign the ticket, too. But, common question. And I get it all the time on the stand. Any lawyers? Willing to admit it? Lawyers are an interesting breed. I work with them all the time. Because I guess I'm on camera. You know, love them. They like to get under your skin, or at least try. And so they get pretty aggressive. And well, so how accurate are these boxes? You know, can't they be wrong? You know, obviously, if it's sending their guy to prison, they would like for it to be wrong. And they'll come pretty aggressively. And I'll tell you, it's going to have to be the last time I ever testify. But just one day, I really want to answer the question, so how accurate are they? This way.
Dead on balls accurate. Here's a certificate of validation.
Dead on, bulls, accurate.
It's an industry term.
I'm hoping. I mean, would be cited for contempt, but it might be worth it. So, I'm standing up here telling you these things are amazing. They're completely accurate. They never fail, and they're always right. I'm not making that claim. Obviously, anything man-made can malfunction. But what's more common is that you don't actually understand what it's telling you. It may be right, but appear to be wrong. And so let's look at something. This is an older version, because this is a relatively old download, of some crash data from one of these boxes. Look very much like this one. And this is one of those that gets 5 seconds of pre-crash data. Minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And we get four parameters that are graphed. In red, we've got vehicle speed, so that's this line. And then it goes under the blue line here. Engine RPM, percent throttle, and remember, brakes on or off. So they're either on or off. We don't know to what extent the brake pedal is being applied. We want to know vehicle speed, right? This car was involved in a crash. How fast is it going? Well, what's it doing? It's going, what, 20-something? And all of a sudden, it's getting down to zero, and it stays at zero. So realistically, you would conclude this car came to a stop, and this is the victim car. Then it got hit, right? He was at a stop. How much hitting can you do? So we download the car, case solved, we're done, move on, right? There's our crash. So this vehicle was stopped. And so basically what we have happen is the vehicle stopped and the fence jumped out and got the front end of this car. That's what the download says, right? That's what it says. We get the graph in the older version. We also get the data. And I know this is a lot of stuff, and you're not used to reading it and looking at it. But let me point out a couple of things. Here's our picture. Brakes. You actually get 8 seconds of brake data in this car. It's a countdown. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Off, 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 on. Then they came on. So for the last couple seconds, they came on, leading up to the crash. How about our vehicle speed? Well, we're going 24, 24, brakes came on, down to nothing. And it says we were at a stop for actually, what, a couple of seconds before the fence jumped out and got us. Well, it's actually a skid test gone bad. it was wet, and the car skidded a little further than what was anticipated. What happens when you slam on your brakes to your wheel speed? It goes to zero. Doesn't mean the car went to zero. Well, where do these things get their readings? They don't have a radar gun. There's not a radar gun mounted in the bumper giving you, you know, live display of speed. It has to get a vehicle speed reading from some sensor. And it either gets it from a drivetrain sensor, you know, somewhere on maybe the back of the transmission, the transaxle, or a wheel speed sensor. Well, we saw the brakes got slammed on. The wheels weren't turning. The car was sliding. It reports zero. All right. It's good to know. So this was a Yukon. And I'll get rid of the suspense. This was involved in a crash. Okay? So we'll just cut to the chase. It was actually a very high-speed rollover down near San Diego. Drift one way, drift the other way, overcorrect, tumble, tumble, tumble. And so here's our download. Well, let's look. How good a car do you have to go from 93 to 158 in a second? And the reason I'm asking, I think we probably have a very educated audience. And if you know what car it is, please tell me. I want one. I want this thing. But I already told you about the wreck. Tumble, tumble, tumble. If you get going a certain speed and you drive off a cliff and get airborne, what happens to your wheel speed? There's no resistance anymore. It's free to ramp up. That is a possible but improbable explanation here. This is for the tech geeks. Anybody not interested in technical stuff can tune out for the next 20 seconds. 158 is the maximum recordable speed in that module. And it has to do with the binary conversion to hexadecimal to kilometers per hour to miles per hour. In hexadecimal, 158 represents 256K, 255, I believe, I'm sorry. And that's FF in hexadecimal. And that's where this comes from. And the rest of you maybe can tune back in now. But this is a maximum recordable value. And these things can have electronic hiccups. I mean, if they get slammed really hard, just like any electronic device, and that may be a momentary, you know, smack on the speed sensor or something. The rest appears to be perfectly valid, but that one's, we'll call it questionable. So the bottom line.
All the boys are calling crazy girl.
I hope she sings this tonight.
I know.
Hey, Dad, pull over. We need gum.
Come on.
Oh, honey.
Here's some money.
What do we got here?
I love it.
Lesson learned.
Daddy.
It's not as simple as plugging in, get your data, and move on. You actually still have to look at all that traditional stuff we started off with. Skids, scrapes, scuffs, gouges. You know what? Look at momentum. Look at crush. You've seen some of the things. I mean, nothing's perfect. I mean, short of an actual radar gun on the car and a video recording of the crash, you've still got to work with your evidence. And so you've still got to use this as a tool. But you still have to understand your crash because it may not be reporting what you believe it's reporting. How about survivability? Well, they've subjected them to all kinds of things. Let's freeze them. Let's corrode them. You know, I told you it's not a black box. Got one out of here. There it is. Downloaded fine. It's all charred. This thing. This is actually the passenger seat. So I'm looking in the passenger door, and it's underneath this molten crud. And so with a pry bar and a chisel, chiseled it out, like chiseling out lava. There it is. Downloaded perfectly. They can survive just about anything except an amateur stereo installer. Pretty much anything. Mother Nature couldn't kill it. A 16-year-old could. Yeah. So I want to show you some cases. I hope none of you have been involved in too many wrecks, but this is actually a diagram from a police report on a fairly simple collision. Arrows represent cars, but in fact, in this case, there's only two cars. There's this one, a drunk driver, that runs into the left rear of this one, which is a person just traveling down the road. The person who was traveling down the road almost experiences what we see on the news, one of those pit maneuvers where the police hit somebody, tumbled, and died. It was a fatality. The bad guy, out of control, hit a wall again, he's fine. But of course. And so this is the bad guy's car. Chevy Malibu, you can see not too much. This was one of those offset right front to left rear, you know, type crashes, but it's at freeway speeds. It's at night on the freeway. And here's the victim's car, and there's where the victim got hit, almost just a tap from the rear to get him sideways. And we have a witness to this crash. And of course you can read it, but essentially the witness says this: I'm driving along, and I see a car coming up pretty quick from behind me, and the car goes to the left, passes me, goes to the right in front of me, and is heading for the SUV that's in front of me, and tried to swerve and avoid it, but didn't. And that's how this happened. So that's our witness, a pretty good witness. But obviously, witnesses get attacked by attorneys. Stories get forgotten and or changed or things. But I took the witness story and I said, the witness says this. That's the witness story. All right, let's download the bad guy's car, the Malibu. Let's see what it says. Bunch of data, obviously. But let's focus in on a couple of things. Here's the speed. Well, 82. Okay, that's enough to go around somebody on the freeway at night, 22 freeway. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So here's our countdown to crash, and then, whoa, you know what? I'm about to hit somebody, so that seems logical. But look what this one gives you. Steering wheel angle. It reads your steering wheel. Negative is left. Positive is right. That's SAE convention. Negative 48, positive 32, whoa, negative 80. So let's put them together, what the witness says and what the steering wheel for the bad guy did. And let's watch. What else do you need? I mean, is anything this witness now says on the stand pretty much golden? They nailed it. This lady nailed it, what happened in this crash, completely corroborated by essentially an electronic recording. And so worrying about her getting attacked or her story getting attacked just went away. Immediate plea of guilty. There's some applications that this thing can delve into fraud. So, you know, not that fraud's a problem, but you got three cars. We see this wreck every day on the freeway, don't we? 1, 2, and 3, right? Let me ask you, if your car B, the middle car, because you got it from both ends, is it a big deal whether or not you hit this car first or the other guy rear-ended you into that car? Insurance-wise, is that a big deal? Yeah. Well, let me ask you, what's driver A going to say? I don't know, I felt two hits. Boom, boom. Well, who first? I don't know. They're going to feel two hits, right? What's driver B going to say? Well, I got rear-ended and forced into, you know, that car. And what's C going to say? Well, no. He rear-ended him, and then I came in, you know, at the end. When you get there, what's the cop going to do? Heads or tails? You know, what are we going to do? You don't know. Well, this is from a car B. Now, you're going to see there's actually two events, deployment, non-deployment. Are you going to get a deployment when you're rear-ended? No. An airbag doesn't help you in a rear-ender. Now, if it ultimately results in a frontal crash, sure. But in a rear-ender, you should not get a deployment. The airbag doesn't do you any good. So look at here. Time between non-deployment and deployment, 1.8 seconds. That seems interesting, right? 1.8 seconds between crashes. You know what's more? They occur in the order stated. Non-deployment first for the middle car. All right. Well, let's look at the data some more. If there's 5 seconds from two events and they're only 1.8 apart, these events should overlap, right? There should be common data. Well, they do. Speed, 39, 36, 33. Speed, 39, 36, 33. These two events overlap. But it just so happens we know what order they happened in, and look at what happened to the middle car speed. He's going 39, 36, 33 because the brakes are on, and then all of a sudden he's going 45. He got rear-ended, sped up into the front car, solved this crash. How do we know this is correct? I mean, how do we actually know? It was a crash test. It was staged. That's the crash. It's pretty good stuff. So as you heard in the intro, I got to handle the Andrew Gallo case, which is the fatality involving Angels pitcher Nick Adenhart.
Shocking news into SportsCenter. Angels rookie pitcher Nick Adenhart was killed early this morning in a three-car accident in Southern California. It's believed a motorist in a minivan ran a red light, sending a second car into a light pole, killing three of the car's four passengers. This according to authorities. The fourth passenger said to be in intensive care at UC Irvine Medical Center. The 22-year-old Adenhart scattered seven hits over six scoreless innings last night against the Oakland A's. No word yet on if the Angels' scheduled game tonight against the A's in Anaheim will be played.
The DA's office in Orange County, California, announcing three counts of murder against the man accused of killing Angels rookie pitcher Nick Adenhart and two other passengers in a car accident early Thursday morning. The driver of the minivan that caused the accident, 22-year-old Andrew Thomas Gallo, was also charged with three other counts in the accident that left one other passenger hospitalized in critical condition. Prosecutors saying tonight that Gallo's blood alcohol level was three times the legal limit. Gallo is being held without bond and is scheduled to be arraigned on Monday.
These are the vehicles involved. Gallo's mom's van. Courtney Stewart, Henry Pearson, John Woolhite, and Nick Adenhart in this vehicle. And this was our witness to the collision, who was also a party. That's the scene. You can see the skids, scrapes, scuffs, and gouges, everything that's there. Points of rest. Did a traditional analysis. Let's document vehicle damage. Let's measure for energy and crush, and let's look at momentum. Let's examine every item of evidence we have, and that fell upon me. Looking at impact angles, trajectories, what we would call conservation of linear momentum, analyzing this impact. This is actually the motion of the vehicles. Gallo coming in, victims coming top to bottom. Silver doesn't show up real well on white paper, so they became blue. And here's our party three, who gets tapped in the post-impact motion of the Mitsubishi, which was driven by the victims. That's essentially what we would call a motion analysis or dynamics diagram. And so we do a traditional analysis, and we come up with him going about 66 miles an hour through a red light into the side of their car. It's about 66 at impact. The crash looks something like this. Toyota, which Andrew Gallo's vehicle was a 2004 Toyota Sienna. Toyota has some very good data in their cars, and they are very, very supportive of law enforcement in extracting that data, providing it, I actually have a very close personal relationship working with Toyota, and they've been fantastic. And so we downloaded Gallo's van. And the important stuff is right here. Leading up to the crash, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then at time of a deployment, at time of a command. And here we go. But what's more telling, I think, because remember, he got charged with murder, and we're looking at a very egregious act. Could the argument be made? You know what? Sure, he was going a little bit fast, but he did everything he could to avoid this. I mean, he did everything he could. Look at the brakes. This is a stale red light. It's probably been red for 20 seconds. And he is accelerating toward a red light, not hitting the brakes. And it largely did him in at trial. There were no defenses.
Is in. Andrew Gallo has been convicted of three counts of second-degree murder in the drunk driving deaths of Promising Angels pitcher Nick Adenhart and his two friends. Let's go live to Carolyn Costello outside court in Santa Ana. Carolyn.
Yeah, Micah, in order to get that murder conviction, prosecutors had to prove a number of things, one of them being that Andrew Gallo knew drunk driving could kill, and he did it anyway.
So, I'm going to leave you with one final thought, and it's actually in the form of a question. We'll see if anybody knows. Can anybody tell me the significance of these three dates? Anybody have any idea? Since 1968, there are only 3 days on which there have been no traffic fatalities in California. And that's basically why we do what we do. It is sad to say, but there's no shortage of business. That's all I have, and be happy to, take any questions or...